I'm Kate McCann. I'm Madeleine's mum. She's like a little buddy to me, you know.
We have to live with the fact that we weren't there.
A desperate search for the toddler began, involving resort staff and holidaymakers alike.
I just remember saying, not Madeleine, not Madeleine, not Madeleine.
I felt like you were in the middle of a horror movie, really. A nightmare.
Kate and Jerry McCann have both been today declared acquittals.
Don't let people tell you that there is no hope.
I know how much I love Madeleine, and I have no doubt that Madeleine knows how much, you know, I love her.
Some sort of good has to come of this. It will make Europe a safer place for children.
Maddie, ano depois. Janeiro de 2008. Passaram 8 meses desde que Madeleine McCann, de 3 anos de idade, desapareceu durante umas férias em Portugal. Os pais, Kate e Jerry McCann, regressaram à sua casa em Rothley, em Inglaterra, com os dois filhos gêmeos, Sean e Amelie, de 2 anos de idade.
I'm on unfamiliar ground here, as I'm not accustomed to writing letters to people I don't know. And so many people have said that, you know. It's a very nice letter. It's actually from a mum, been very supportive in what we've done and are doing. I've got a lot of letters as well from people who've got children the same age.
There's this guy who's apparently a barrister, and he's been contacted and says he has worked for the intelligence services, and has got this huge conspiracy theory, and people have been killed, you know, who took her and passed on, and the German secret service are involved, and she was moved from Portugal to Belgium, and it's the British government know about it, and they didn't try and rescue her, but really, I don't think there's any credibility to it whatsoever.
There's somebody else in Nairobi. But we've had, you know, we've had letters saying she's virtually, you know, been in every country in the world, really, so. I submit the following psychic evidence. Lucid dreams. You know, she could be somewhere by the sea in an attic, but without knowing where to look. I guess because we've had so many thousands and they're virtually all different, it's hard to give them the same importance, really, or weight. Because, you know, she's not in thousands of different places, she's in one place.
They do affect you, even though there's no credibility at all. You start to wonder, and without any hard facts to go on other than what we knew on the night, really. So it's quite difficult.
You might have lost your time spent answering messages. They all positive?
No. I think it's fair to say the vast majority, 99% of them, are really nice and supportive. And then unfortunately, as we know, there's that 1% of society who send the nasty ones.
That's a good example. Giveaway, because normally it's pretty obvious. And this is Jerry and Kate. How can you use money given by poor people in good faith to pay your mortgage on your mansion? You thieving bastards. Your brat is dead because of your drunken arrogance. Shame on you. I curse you and your family to suffer forever. Cursed Christmas. If you had any shame, you would accept full responsibility for your daughter's disappearance and give all the money back. You are scum. It's quite nice, really. So, very charming.
I think they're just saying, why should Madeleine get all this attention? Maybe the question should be, why shouldn't Ormiston children get more attention?
Every time I watch that video, it brings it back, and that's actually our Madeleine and our daughter. And I really like that, because most of the time when we're talking about Madeleine, it's almost, it's like the Madeleine that's in the papers, and she's an abstract concept. And we've given a lot more of Madeleine than we would ever have wanted to, but all with a view to, you know, hoping to trigger something. We'll do anything to try and find her. It brings it back.
Jerry loves that photo. As part of the kids' club, they did like a mini tennis. And she really enjoyed it. Yeah.
One of the tasks was to gather all the balls up. And she'd obviously managed to get three, and she turned round to Kate and she's like, "There, I've got them all."
She's very loving. She's a very bright little girl. I had days where I'd go to a cafe with Madeleine and we go shopping together, and you know, she just, you know, just so she, "Oh, Mummy, I like that top. Oh, I love your earrings, Mummy," you know, and she's good company. She's like my, you know, she's like a little buddy to me, you know.
She looks like Kate. Thank goodness for that. But in terms of personality trait, she's more like my side of the family, I think. She's very outgoing. She was a bit of a ringleader in the nursery and the other friends. And it's always, it's bizarre, because every time I was going to nursery, say, "Oh, are you Madeleine?" Stones was always talking about Madeleine, and it was all the parents, like, you know, you start thinking, "Oh my goodness, what has she been doing?" But, you know, she's just really outgoing, good fun, bundles of energy, and very loving. She was a little person becoming independent and a piece of, you know, just endless joy. I remember Kate saying that she wanted us to get a photo together. I think she'd been ill leading up to that, and she was really tired. But she sat there absolutely brilliant, and she's just amazing. Sat there, and the twins were in good form.
Yeah, she was great with Sean and Emily, and that. You know, even when she was, when they were born, you know, she just stepped into the role really well, considering, you know, she was only 20 months when they were born, and she wanted to be involved and help, and then obviously they got a little bit older because the age difference is so close. They just played so well together. And it was just lovely seeing them together. And that's one thing that I struggle with, is imagining how they'd be now.
It's like in the bushes.
Após o desaparecimento da filha, Kate e Jerry McCann tomaram uma decisão. Tentar impedir que o que aconteceu a Madeleine aconteça a outras crianças. Quando começaram a aperceber-se do número de crianças desaparecidas na Europa, ficaram revoltados. A reação das autoridades ao rapto de menores pareceu-lhes fortuita e desorganizada.
We feel a moral obligation, given the huge amount of support we've had, that some sort of good has to come of this, and we have to leave a tangible benefit. And I think one of the ways we can do this is to direct that into saying, look, here are things that will make Europe a safer place for children. In terms of campaign, rather than just things that are absolutely directly related to finding Madeleine, these are what we call our wider agenda, the wider agenda around child abduction. I think the first thing is to get an EU-wide child alert.
As primeiras horas são de importância crucial e são a melhor oportunidade de se encontrar uma criança raptada ainda com vida. Nos Estados Unidos, aciona-se um sistema de salvamento de crianças, denominado o Alerta Amarelo. A polícia faz de imediato apelos nas televisões e rádios, alertando a população para o desaparecimento de uma criança. A maioria dos países europeus não tem nada que se pareça com este sistema. Os McCann querem corrigir esta situação.
Given what we've learned in the last 9 to 10 months, which is incredibly upsetting and distressing, and given obviously that our daughter's been taken and obviously living with the rawness of emotion of that day in, day out, I just don't feel you can turn a blind eye to it. And I want to change it all. Now, obviously, I can't change it all, but, you know, I do feel that I need to do something.
If you find yourself in that horrible situation that we did, you want to know a photograph's going out, a description, borders are being alerted, and that the best possible chance of finding that child quickly.
It's not going to help Madeleine now. We're obviously still looking for Madeleine. But the thought of, you know, other people going through the intensity of this emotion that we've had, and that's knowing how we feel. I can't speak for Madeleine, you know.
And as a parent, I think you want to know everything's been done, because it is the most horrible experience anyone will ever have.
On the 28th of April, and there was 9 adults and the kids.
Oh, hang on, hang on. I think we're on video. Can get everyone in.
Yeah, she was really excited. The whole thing and the video of her on the day and getting up the plane and completely excited about it.
It seemed like the ideal balance, really, having a family holiday, the kids having fun and not getting bored, and for us to have a little bit of time as well. We were having a great time. And the kids, and Madeleine in particular, was having a ball.
Na primeira noite, a família jantou neste restaurante, o Millennium, a cerca de 750 metros do apartamento onde estavam instalados.
But that was a good walk away, and we didn't have a buggy or anything with us. So we did go and we took all the kids. It didn't open till 6:30 or something, and our kids usually go to bed around 7. So they were really tired, and they were walking, but you've got to remember, they're only little. So we ended up having to carry them, trying to carry 3 of them between 2, you know, and we decided we couldn't do that, really. It wasn't fair, and it wasn't, you know, it wouldn't have been good for anybody.
And it turned out our apartments were right next to the tapas, which is literally from the back of ours, about 50 yards, maybe 60. And then so we said, well, why don't we just try and eat there?
Just seemed like a good idea. It didn't.
Two of the other couples had been in Mark Warner holidays before, and they have a baby listening service, which essentially is where someone goes round the apartment, so they don't actually go in, they just listen outside.
And it wasn't until quite late on that we realised there wasn't a baby listening service. But I guess we were just doing our own baby listening service, only we were going inside and checking.
And it seemed a fairly natural sort of thing to do. It was so close. As you say, you can actually see the apartment. And it didn't feel that different to dining out the back garden. And what you wouldn't do is go upstairs and check on your kids every half hour, like we were doing. But it just was the furthest thing from my mind of something like that happening.
I think if there'd even been 1 second where someone had said, do you think it's going to be okay, it wouldn't have happened. You know.
It just felt really safe.
Yeah. I mean, there's absolutely no way, and I've said it before, there's absolutely no way if I'd have had the slightest inkling that there was a risk involved there, that I'd have done it.
Were you surprised by people criticising that?
No. Yeah, people will say that they've never done that, and, you know, who am I to argue? You know, we have to live with the fact that we weren't directly there, and if we were, then, you know, possibly, probably, it wouldn't have happened.
Apesar da procura de Madeleine ser a primeira prioridade, Kate e Jerry querem fazer o possível para evitar que o mesmo aconteça a outras crianças. Ficaram estupefactos ao tomar conhecimento de que na Grã-Bretanha desaparecem 100 mil crianças por ano. No entanto, não existe nenhum organismo oficial inteiramente dedicado à procura dessas crianças. Os pais de crianças desaparecidas têm de recorrer a instituições de caridade para obter ajuda.
Just off to see Catherine there, who's the founder of PACT, which is a UK-based organisation, and it's parents and abducted children together.
She's been very driven to try and improve how missing and abducted children are dealt with. She's done really well in trying to drive change, so it's going to be good to speak to her.
Lady Catherine Mayer criou a instituição de caridade depois de uma batalha jurídica para ficar com os dois filhos do seu primeiro casamento.
Hi.
Quando voltou a casar com o embaixador britânico em Washington, aderiu à luta por uma melhor reação internacional quanto às crianças raptadas.
Kate and I are very, very passionate and want to see change for good. And out of all the support we've had regarding Madeleine's abduction, we want to try and channel that into getting a successful child rescue alert system implemented across the European Union.
I'm sure one day it will happen. The question is when and how quickly. And I think, you know, the point is that one is in a hurry. You know, things sometimes take 10, 20 years to change, but the question is when you're today, you want it to happen tomorrow.
Yeah.
I think the level of media attention regarding Madeleine's disappearance throughout Europe is unprecedented, and this is the opportunity to capitalise when it's very fresh in people's mm-hmm. memories.
Child Rescue Alert is a very, very good project. It is something that should be implemented in all European countries. And I think if anybody can, it's the two of you, because of the people you are.
This is it. This is the UK National Charity for Missing. These guys are quite expert in what they do, both on the research and policy of missing and the huge gaps and lack of knowledge that you may also have discovered that we have. There's so much information we just still don't know about missing subjects. We spend about £2 million a year, and quite frankly, it's a national disgrace that that's all we've got to operate on.
Well, Madeleine's profile's high. I mean, we're here and... advantage of it, you know, if we can be of any use, you know, sort of.
I mean, I think your case has catapulted the whole issue of missing, as, mm-hmm. you know, not just in the UK but around the world. You know, certainly from our point of view, there's a lot more people now interested in the wider issue.
You've become a symbol for mm-hmm. the pain of so many people who have somebody who's gone missing. It's trying to raise that issue, because when you're looking at figures like 210,000 people a year go missing, as a society, what do we need to do to support people in that situation?
Changes aren't done by individuals. You know, the system is filled with bureaucrats, and it's incredibly difficult to change things. But if you have two individuals, like they are, who are passionate about an issue, I think they have a huge amount of chance to change things. But what is horrible is that it takes a horrible situation like that to happen in their lives for change to happen.
It's the fifth night. We reserve the table at 8:30. By 9, everybody was there. It was on the third check, which is my check, that I went. And I discovered Madeleine had been taken. I've rushed around the apartment really quickly, just opened up cupboards and things, and then just went flying out down to the tapas restaurant, shouting, "Someone's taken Madeleine." And that's when the nightmare started.
Everyone knows the fear. I think fear is probably the right word. Fear for your daughter, fear for yourself, fear for your family, fear for everything. And that horrible kind of adrenaline, fight or flight.
And I just remember saying, "Not Madeleine, not Madeleine, not Madeleine." And I can just remember saying that over and over and over again. Jerry was the same, you know, he's kind of, I'm not used to seeing Jerry, obviously, that upset and...
Some things kicked in, and there was a lot of activity within the group, quickly. And I don't know if it's used to dealing with very stressful situations at work, or otherwise, but, you know, there was definitely, let's do this, you know, call the police, do all the things, alert people, coordinate.
I can remember our friends shouting, "We need to close the borders," and they were shouting, "Morocco, Algiers," you know, I can remember all this going on, and "Roadblocks, we need roadblocks." I mean, it was our friends that were kind of saying this.
I was pretty adamant Kate should stay in the apartment in case Madeleine was found, so we knew where to bring her right away.
I was mainly in the bedroom, and I was just praying, actually. I was just ringing people and getting everyone to pray, and I just felt so helpless.
Later on, there was a period where she hadn't turned up. It was absolute devastation and total, just total emotion, really.
It was really cold, you know. I knew what pajamas she had on, and I just thought she was going to be freezing. And it was just dark and dark, and every minute seemed like an hour. And obviously we were up all night, and we just waited for that first bit of light, so at 6 o'clock.
And then we went out searching, two of us at daylight.
It was just deserted. And we were just searching through the undergrowth, through bushes.
We were saying over and over again, just let her be found, let her be found.
Kate e Jerry vão a Bruxelas visitar Crianças Desaparecidas na Europa, uma instituição que representa todas as caridades direcionadas para o desaparecimento de crianças no continente. A instituição também tem feito campanha para a adoção de um sistema de alerta de crianças desaparecidas. E apesar de ser apoiado pela Comissão Europeia, o sistema foi adotado apenas em 4 países, incluindo a Grã-Bretanha. Portugal e mais 22 Estados-membros não possuem qualquer sistema de alerta. A reunião é com Delfim Morales.
There seems to be some resistance to actually introducing an Amber Alert type system already. Is that your view?
What we do regret is the fact that there was, I think, a lack of understanding of what an EU child alert is exactly. The idea that is that for very worrying cases of missing children, alert systems can be launched locally, nationally, and where possible in a cross-border region, beyond the national border.
Because especially if you look at Belgium, where you're surrounded by other countries where you could be abducted here and be in France or Luxembourg Netherlands or Germany before the alerts even
gone out. When you look at the case of the child that was missing in August in France, he was missing in the north of France. He was very close to the Belgian border. Everybody in the south of France was informed of his disappearance. No one was over the border in Belgium.
Yeah.
This is absurd because it's much more likely that the child would have been in Belgium than in the south of France.
Maybe I'm being a bit extreme here, but you can't help but think it sounds like such a vital thing to have in place, that children should have some importance in the EU.
The society should be measured to the way they treat their children. And I think when you look at the way we've, you know, been doing that in Europe, we still have a lot of work to do.
Por estranho que pareça, ninguém sabe ao certo quantas crianças são raptadas na Europa. E para cada caso altamente mediatizado, como o de Madeleine, há muitos outros que não chegam à comunicação social. O orçamento de crianças desaparecidas na Europa é inferior a 370 mil euros. E a maior parte provém de donativos.
Slightly surprised at just how small the organisation is. To have 2.5 people, I think, sums it up for me pretty clearly.
I think the obsessive thing for me is you'd expect that each of the EU member states would be jumping at the chance of making their country some way safer for children. And that's obviously not the case, and whether that's apathy or whether it's because of financial resources, limitation, or whether it's a case of, well, let's just be reactive, let's wait till more children have been taken, then maybe we'll do something about it. And I find that attitude very demoralising, really.
A desperate search for the toddler began, involving resort staff and holidaymakers alike.
Whoever was responsible, it's feared that it was a well-planned operation, the perpetrator watching the hotel complex.
Tonight, forensic teams were even searching buildings surrounding this resort.
Every minute, every hour is time without Madeleine. And that Friday, I was watching the clock in the police station, so that's so many hours, and then it's 24 hours and you're back to another dark, cold night. And
when we came back from the police station on the first night, I just said, I want to appeal, you know, I want people looking for her. Do as much as we can, as quickly as possible. And clearly there were, you know, what we didn't know was when we got back, there was just, you know, hundreds of journalists. Now, what was going through my mind at that point was first and foremost that we wanted to do whatever we could to try and help find Madeleine. Let the media help find Madeleine.
Words cannot describe the anguish and despair that we are feeling as the parents of our beautiful daughter Madeleine. We request that anyone who may have any information related to Madeleine's disappearance, no matter how trivial, contact the Portuguese police and help us get her back safely. Please, if you have Madeleine, let her come home to her mummy, daddy, brother and sister.
It was really hard those first few days. I just feared the worst at the beginning. Probably for the first few days we were like that. I was just like praying and praying that wasn't the case. And
till now, Madeleine's mum had been too upset to make a public appeal.
Jerry and I were just...
Numbness sort of kicked in. And you can't have that raw emotion 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You just can't. Physically, you can't do it. And I'm sure that's self-protection as well. But also, I think the psychological element of kicking in and actually saying, well, we do have some influence in this. So what I think we wanted to do is to make sure we'd done everything absolutely possible to try and help and influence that search.
We had like behavioural specialist profilers out who were telling us not to show emotion in case the abductor gets a kick out of it, you know, and so you've got the pressure of not showing emotion to protect your daughter. And
Madeleine is a beautiful, bright, funny and caring little girl. She is so special. Please, please do not hurt her. Please don't scare her. Please tell us where to find her. Or put her in a place of safety and let somebody know where she is. We beg you to let Madeleine come home. We need our Madeleine. Sean and Emily need Madeleine, and Madeleine needs us. Please give our little girl back. Por favor, devolva a nossa menina.
For us, it was about getting information into the inquiry. And that was something that, if we didn't do it, who else was going to do it?
you suddenly realise that being helpless and in a heap isn't going to bring Madeleine back. You know, and it sounds easy when I'm saying it there, and obviously it wasn't easy, because the sort of the rawness of it, and obviously the thoughts we were having. But I mean, we still managed to hang in there.
Sete de maio, a filha desaparecera há 4 dias. Mas isto é apenas o início de um episódio longo e sombrio. Passaram 262 dias desde o desaparecimento de Madeleine. Mas hoje há uma nova pista.
Find this man. Is this the person who kidnapped Madeleine McCann? It's claimed 3 different witnesses say the new artist's impression could be the man they believe snatched Madeleine.
Detetives particulares, contratados pelos McCann, obtiveram a descrição de um homem que se comportava de forma estranha na Praia da Luz em maio do ano passado.
With the power of the modern media and the reach of television in particular and the internet, if this man is pretty much anywhere in the Western world, we believe that somebody somewhere will recognize him and will make contact. That's what we need. We need to find him and find him quickly.
The hope is that someone else would come forward and say, I saw a man like this and I can describe his face, and maybe even someone to come forward and say, I know who that was. You always hope that. But it has given the investigators a bit of a boost and more information coming in, so hopefully that will continue.
Verão de 2007. Na ausência de um sistema de alerta de desaparecimento de crianças em Portugal, cabe aos pais de Madeleine manterem as atenções centradas no desaparecimento da filha.
There's only one goal, and that is finding Madeleine. But I think the way we tackled it was we set ourselves objectives.
And we had a job to do. We had a job to do for Madeleine.
Last night, the McCanns reluctantly said goodbye to their twins to fly to Rome.
We decided that, you know, we'd go around the... you know, certain countries in Europe for a specific reason, to appeal to people to try and get information in.
The McCanns plan to visit Spain, Germany, the Netherlands and Morocco in their ongoing campaign to keep the disappearance of their child high profile.
Kate McCann described it as the best welcome to Morocco she could have had.
As the Pope stopped to talk to them, Kate McCann leant towards him. Will you bless a picture of Madeleine, she whispered. It is an astonishing, unique story of parents asking the world not to forget.
If you have seen this little girl, please give any information that you have, any genuine information that you have.
I appeal to anyone with information to come forward. Please come forward.
I'm here to try and urge you to carry on supporting the search and do everything we can to bring her home safely.
I was really scared. I hate putting myself forward, to, you know, I prefer to sort of be in the background, and I found it really intimidating. And I remember, I think I'd woken up and not being great when I woke up. I'm thinking, I don't know if I can do this. But then I think, well, I can't not do it for Madeleine. And, you know, I remember being in the toilet and trying to, you know, get myself together, and then when I was okay, I said, right, let's go. And we went and we did the stuff and held up the pajamas and all that kind of stuff.
And the night Madeleine was taken, she
She was wearing pyjamas almost identical to these ones.
White pyjama bottoms with a floral print on, and another picture of Eeyore on the right leg, lower right leg. Well, then I went straight back into the toilet, you know, and my job was done. Which was the purpose of it.
It was good for everyone to feel that they were doing things and achieve it. And you got high in a lift, and that works, and you think, right, okay, what else can we achieve? And you set your next goal. But then, of course, following the achievement of lots of the goals, then there was a down, major down, because you'd done all of these things, the whole world knows about Madeleine, but we still haven't found her. So you're measuring success with things that actually don't equate to what you really want, which is your primary objective of finding Madeleine.
Aproximava-se o centésimo dia do desaparecimento de Madeleine e a luta para encontrar a filha estava prestes a tornar-se ainda mais difícil.
August, start of August, that marked a definite change, a dramatic change actually.
Portuguese police, they were the law enforcement agency tasked with finding Madeleine. We'd obviously stayed and wanted to be close to the investigation, and our meetings with the police where we got information made us feel a lot better.
But suddenly we had no communication with the police, and we were back to that void of information, no communication. What's happening? What's happening in the search for my daughter? Are we getting closer? Is anybody looking for my daughter? What's happening? And it's back to that horrible feeling again of helplessness.
We certainly felt we had developed a very good working relationship with the senior officers, and that changed very abruptly.
I went to collect Sean and Amelie from Kids Club, and I was just coming out with them in the double buggy, and suddenly all these cameras and reporters just kind of surrounded us, and it was totally unexpected, because I mean that hadn't happened for ages, and they were taking pictures of the kids, and there'd been an understanding that that wouldn't happen, and that was a change. And I was trying to get past, and each way I went they were all kind of running and surrounding us, and at that point I was thinking, what's going on here?
Good evening. ITV News has learned tonight of another sensational development in the Madeleine McCann investigation.
Attention has returned to Prior de Luche. The world's media is now camped outside the McCann's villa. The focus is now firmly and entirely on the parents.
De acordo com relatos na imprensa, foram encontrados vestígios de sangue no apartamento e o ADN de Madeleine foi detectado no carro alugado pelo casal, onde os cães pesteiros também detectaram o cheiro da morte.
Suddenly the Portuguese press was full of evidence that Madeleine was dead. And that we were involved, and that was a shock to the system.
There is speculation among the Portuguese media that charges may be laid against the couple next week.
As soon as I realised the story or theory or whatever you want to call it was that Madeleine was dead, and that we'd been involved somehow, it just hit home. They haven't been looking for Madeleine. And it was just, I just felt, yet again, my daughter's had such a disservice, and I was obviously upset by that, very upset, and I was angry, you know. And I just thought she deserves so much better than that. And I thought, I'm not going to sit here and allow this, you know.
What did the police say?
We got told we'd be getting interviews again, and we should bring our lawyer with us. And at that point, as a witness, you weren't allowed to have a lawyer. So Jerry said, what status will we be under? And they said, Arguido.
Arguido é qualquer indivíduo com interesse para a investigação. Mas, para a imprensa, significava que os pais de Madeleine eram suspeitos. De repente, passaram eles a ser o objeto da investigação.
Pressure that such as I've never felt before, because you're under attack in one way or another. Speculation takes you to the worst places, and at that point, you know, the worst place would have been being charged, potentially being put in jail, certainly being detained to face charges that could have taken, I don't know, years to materialise, being separated from John and Emily. These sort of things were going through your mind, and you're, because it's a system that you're unfamiliar with, you don't know what could happen.
I started thinking, well, if they're saying that about us being involved with Madeleine, you know, it's not long before they say, what about Sean and Emily? What about their other two children? And I can remember saying to Jerry's mum and Jerry's sisters, do not let anyone near them. And they were like, don't you worry, you know. And it was back again to the sort of lioness and the cubs, you know, I'd just do whatever it took to protect them.
It felt like you were in the middle of a horror movie, really. A nightmare.
When I was going in to become Arguido, because I felt angry, I felt strong. I wasn't scared. I felt like I was going to fight the world, to be honest. My daughter was worth more than all that, and I would do whatever it took to fight for justice and truth.
A survival. There's no doubt about it. We've got other children, we've got each other, and if we had crumpled or done anything else, then ultimately, who's looking for Madeleine?
O Estatuto de Arguidos significa que os McCann continuam a não ter autorização para falar sobre o que aconteceu nas instalações da polícia. Foi noticiado, no entanto, que teria sido proposto um acordo a Kate. Confessar ter morto acidentalmente Madeleine em troca de uma pena reduzida.
You know, I'd have fought to the death, to be honest, at that point. There's no way I was gonna be railroaded into something. It's funny, I felt almost invincible at that point. I just didn't know what kicked in. You know, I just thought, my children deserve her. Madeleine deserves her. Someone has to be fighting for Madeleine.
Kate and Jerry McCann have both been today declared arguidos with no bail conditions, and no charges have been brought against them. The investigation continues.
Jerry, you are
good evening. I can't say anything, I'm afraid.
How do you feel, Ray? How do you feel, Mr. McCann?
Tired.
It's absolutely essential that you survive and you go through it and you come out the other end.
Juice. Orange juice or apple?
Apple.
I hope there's some left.
Not everything.
You can like it.
I
want
some mummy.
I want some
mummy. Good boy, well rescued.
Mummy, that one.
Okay, you have these. Let's move it a bit closer so it doesn't. How are you doing, Emily? Cover your mouth when you're coughing. Should I get you a tissue?
Yeah, tissue,
I've got a tissue.
Tomorrow's quite a significant landmark, really, for us. And since Madam has taken, you kind of cling to stories of children that have been returned. And I mean, I remember in the early days someone saying a little boy had been taken, he was returned at 17 days, and you know, it seemed like a lifetime in the first week, but 17 days, and then we went past that, and then I can remember Sabine Dardenne, I think she was 80 days, and we went past that, and there's been others along the way, but I think the one that's kind of kept me going really was Elizabeth Smart. You know, and the last few months, you know, I've been thinking, well, Elizabeth Smart was 9 months, you know, and, you know, they didn't think, you know, they had nothing to say she's going to be back tomorrow, and yet it was 278 days for her, and it's 278 days for us tomorrow. That's quite... Sorry. We're never going to get to a day where you think, okay, we've tried everything now and we're exhausted and we need to start living. I can't imagine ever getting to that day, you know, so I just think, well, we need to know, because the thought of living like this for another 40 years isn't exactly, you know, a happy prospect. So.
Kate e Jerry estão em Washington, no âmbito da campanha para auxiliar as crianças raptadas. Há 6 anos, os americanos acompanharam um caso de uma criança desaparecida, tal como Madeleine. Elizabeth Smart também desaparecera da sua cama a meio da noite. 9 meses depois, Elizabeth foi encontrada viva. Quando Madeleine desapareceu, Ed Smart, pai de Elizabeth, contactou os McCann. Hoje vão encontrar-se pela primeira vez.
Hi.
Hey, how are you?
Ed, hi. Nice to meet you eventually.
Nice to meet you.
And you.
It's lovely.
Hi,
how are you doing?
Good to meet you.
How are you two doing?
We're okay, sort of, some good days and some desperate days still.
I think we're bearing up, really. Still working away behind the scenes and keep plugging away and keep hoping for the breakthrough, really.
Any tips or anything that's come up?
Not anything I would say that's particularly hot.
Of information we have really is that a man was seen carrying Madeleine away at the top of the road on the 3rd of May and since that.
But you can never give up hope. One of our friends said, you know, Ed, the most important thing you can do is keep her face out there.
Durante meses, o pai de Elizabeth conseguiu manter o rosto da filha nos jornais e televisões, até que um transeunte acabou por reconhecê-la na rua, acompanhada pelo raptor.
Elizabeth's return was a matter of people were out there watching and looking, and her face had been out there so long, they recognized it was potentially her along with her abductor.
Yeah.
So it's
well, it's a good success story. There's no doubt.
It is. It is.
It's a great story.
No. The chronology of their journey today provides a glimpse into the pressure they're under and the maelstrom of emotions they must be enduring.
9 de setembro de 2007. Passaram mais de 4 meses desde o início das férias em Portugal e 2 meses desde que a polícia os constituiu arguídos. Kate e Jerry McCann decidem que é a altura de regressar a casa.
When we became El Guidos, it was no longer safe to be in Portugal, particularly for Sean and Emily, and it was quite hostile. You know, we had all the cameras and reporters. It wasn't fair on the kids, and it would have been impossible to have continued like that.
It was blatantly apparent that we should leave. So the decision was made. It was made easy to leave, whereas it would have been harder if the situation was different.
I didn't want to be forced to leave Portugal because I felt then that the pressure would be off the authorities to look for her. Emotionally, for me, it was a mixture of things. That was the last place I saw Madeleine. And I suppose I felt closer to her there, even though I didn't know where she was.
Whilst it's heartbreaking to return to the UK without Madeleine, it does not mean we're giving up our search for her. Portuguese law prohibits us from commenting further on the police investigation. Despite there being so much we wish to say, we are unable to do so, except to say this. We have played no part in the disappearance of our lovely daughter, Madeleine.
Being there, being in our family home without Madeleine, it's incredibly hard. And yet at the same time, there was some comfort in it.
Em Washington, Kate e Jerry visitam o Centro Nacional de Defesa de Crianças Desaparecidas e Exploradas, que tem um orçamento superior a 26 milhões de euros por ano, na sua quase totalidade atribuído pelo governo.
Hi.
Hi,
Kate. How are you? Welcome.
I'm glad you're here.
Yeah. Hi, Jerry. Good to see you again.
Welcome.
Thanks for having us.
Sure.
350 funcionários a tempo inteiro, chefiados pelo diretor Ernie Allen, garantem que o desaparecimento de crianças continua a ser uma prioridade política.
She's fine. She's safe. That's all we're worrying about. She's home.
The National Center for Missing and Exploited Children is a non-profit organization that works in partnership with the U.S. Department of Justice. Today, it is the nation's leading organization addressing the problems of missing and exploited children.
This is an activation of the Amber Alert system.
And we quickly distribute Amber Alerts to internet service providers and cell phone companies. America's leading organization for keeping children safe, making a real impact on millions of lives across the nation.
I talk all the time with a young girl who several years ago was rescued from after having been kidnapped by an abductor. This child was literally minutes away from being executed by this guy. And she was saved because a motorist who had seen the vehicle saw a highway sign that said Amber Alert and the description of the automobile. The sheriff's deputies literally arrived on the scene as the guy was getting out of the car, gun in hand, to kill her. And the police and the abductor had a shootout, and the abductor was killed. So it works. These are some of the latest data. 80% of the kids who were rescued within 72 hours of the activation. 68 kids were rescued specifically as a result of Amber Alert activations last year. So that's sort of the rationale on getting the information out quickly. And I think this is an ideal time to send a message to leaders of Europe and leaders around the world that we're not doing enough.
Coming up to the year, I've got to push this on. Because the media attention this time around it's going to be massive again, and so we want to capitalise on that, and hopefully we'll get somebody coming forward with about Madeleine as well.
Well, you continue to generate leads.
Yeah. We're a bit light on leads at the minute, but we're working on them.
Yeah.
Keep working.
You know, don't let people tell you that just because it's been 6 months or a week or a year or 4 years, that there is no hope. You know, you keep battling for your child. There are a host of scenarios under which your child could be alive.
More positive about the chances of Madeleine being out there, and I feel more positive about the likelihood of being able to implement an Amber Alert system within Europe, and obviously that the people that we've met in the last 2 days are incredibly committed, positive, gives you hope for actually achieving the same kind of thing within Europe.
We've spoken to a lot of people who've said this is a country that has more than 2 stereotypical kidnappings per week, and of those, only 40-50% end up being found dead. And most importantly of all, the younger the child, the less likely of serious harm. And these are people inexperienced in investigation saying, I really believe she's out there. And I think yesterday was the first time when I thought, I really believe it. Somebody knows. And they might not know that they know, but someone knows something. Someone's got a key bit of information, and we just need to unlock that.
She's out there. We've just got to find her. You know, the problem is trying to find her. She's out there. We've got to find her. First came back, you know, I didn't cook a meal, just couldn't do it. All the everyday things that have to be done. You know, there were times in the early days where things like that I resented things like that because it was taking me away from Madeleine. You know, how can I hang up washing when my daughter's not here? But now, you know, you know, we have got Sean and Amelie, and they need a happy, normal life, and they deserve a happy, normal life. And, you know, it's a case of getting up and breakfast and getting dressed. And as you say, there's, you know, with 3 kids, there's always lots of washing. But in some ways, it's good, because you have to do it. You have to focus on it, even if it's for a few minutes.
Life is carrying on to an extent. In a quasi-real existence, a purgatory type existence, where you're kind of between something real and never finding out. But although it was hard, we had decided to reintroduce Sean and Amelie to a degree of normality, and normality is that I go to work.
Mas o dia-a-dia sem Madeleine torna-se ainda mais difícil pelo facto de continuarem a ser arguídos. Vivem sob suspeita e no desconhecimento total em relação aos desenvolvimentos da investigação. Mas à medida que os meses passam, mais dúvidas surgem em relação às alegadas provas contra o casal, o ADN, as amostras de sangue, os cães pesteiros e o cheiro à morte. E hoje surgiram, ao que parece, dúvidas por parte da chefia da polícia portuguesa quanto à forma como o caso foi tratado.
Portugal's most senior policeman says he thinks detectives were too hasty in making the parents of Madeleine McCann official suspects in her disappearance. Alípio Ribeiro said he believed there should have been what he called another assessment before they were made arguidos or suspects. A spokesman for the family said the only proper thing for the police to do now is to eliminate them from the investigation.
I suppose the first thing we heard of it was on Saturday. He volunteered that there should have been another assessment, and he was asked to clarify, and he says, yes, I definitely think that. And he says, was there some haste? And then being declared, he goes, yes, it was a hasty decision. So that's encouraging, it's certainly a step in the right direction.
And you can't help but think that there's key information in Portugal. It's the most likely place where information is going to come from, because that's where she was taken from. You know, and as Jerry said, if the public opinion is that we were involved, or that she's dead, then that information isn't going to come forward. So at least it might a little bit affect public opinion in a positive direction, and hence people might start doubting what's being put out there in the press.
Mas 24 horas depois, as declarações de Alípio Ribeiro são criticadas em Portugal e os jornais noticiam que ele pediu desculpa à Associação Sindical da Polícia. Os McCann sentem que voltaram à estaca zero.
We're not getting any information about the investigation, and that is completely demoralizing.
You know, we're in a situation where our daughter is missing, our daughter's been taken, and we have had no information. And I want someone to put the hand up and say, I think that's humane treatment, because I certainly don't think it is.
Meses sem qualquer informação oficial sobre a investigação não chegam para pararem os títulos dos jornais. Kate e Jerry sabem que eles, e não Madeleine, continuam a ser o centro das atenções.
One of the worst things has been certain sections of the media have decided it's open season and have behaved very irresponsibly, knowing that most of what they're writing is rubbish, but they felt because we are being put in a very difficult legal position, that whole insinuation that everything we've done has been hypocritical and untruthful.
No, the people writing these outrageous headlines, writing total lies, you know, they should really stop and think, we're human beings, we're not just names, we're not just characters, we're human beings.
Os advogados do casal alegam que 108 artigos publicados pelo grupo Express são difamatórios. E vão para o tribunal.
A full apology was read out from Express newspapers as they paid £550,000 in libel damages to the Find Madeleine Fund.
We are pleased that Express newspapers have today admitted the utter falsity of the numerous grotesque and grossly defamatory allegations that their titles published about us on a sustained basis over many months. The exceptional publication of these apologies, together with today's statement of full apology in open court before Mr. Justice Eady, was the only just and proper response by Express newspapers following our complaint.
Clearly, the McCann settlement and its fallout are a warning to those responsible for the excessive coverage in our newspapers.
The Express have been the worst of the papers, and our libel lawyer looked at the Express from August to whenever it all started, and he couldn't believe it, and they said, you know, this is the worst case we've seen in our careers.
The bottom line is that you could have cut a bit of slack at the beginning when sources or, you know, things were coming out of Portugal, and there may have been an argument, people really didn't know whether they were true, but the sources were shown to be wrong so many times.
We'd asked for a front page apology because all the articles against us were on the front page.
It's not right that families could be destroyed with something like this, and action had to be taken.
And I got upset now, but the pain that we were going through, it just makes me so angry, you know.
Abril 2008. A campanha de Kate e Jerry McCann para a introdução de um sistema de alerta de salvamento de crianças está prestes a dar um passo em frente. As pesquisas que têm feito permitem-lhes saberem mais do que a maior parte dos pais sobre o rapto de crianças. Vão levar o dossiê à Europa, apelando a todos os países para que adotem um sistema ao estilo do alerta amarelo dos Estados Unidos. E trabalham com um dos melhores advogados da Grã-Bretanha.
Hi, good to meet you. Come in, Jerry. Hi, Kate.
Jeffrey Robertson, juiz conselheiro, redigirá uma declaração que vão levar ao Parlamento Europeu.
Do the best I can to make it both persuasive and comprehensible.
E hoje, com a declaração, os pais de Madeleine partem para Bruxelas. O objetivo é pressionar, no sentido de colocar o sistema de alerta de salvamento de crianças no topo da agenda política. Mas com a polícia portuguesa a chegar a Leicester para interrogar uma vez mais os amigos de Kate e Jerry McCann, o dia acabaria por dar uma volta totalmente inesperada.
Take you live to Brussels, though, because the parents of Madeleine McCann are there today, supporting an EU alert system for missing children. It's like the Amber Alert system that exists in the United States.
9 de abril de 2008, o que começara quatro meses antes como uma ideia para conseguir obter algo de positivo do desaparecimento de Madeleine, está prestes a tornar-se realidade. Os pais de Madeleine chegam a Bruxelas para apresentar o sistema de alerta amarelo para a Europa.
The couple said they were still hopeful that Madeleine was alive, but the Amber Alert could have helped to find their daughter in those first crucial hours.
Morning, Richard.
Good morning, how are you?
Tahir, how are you?
It's actually an hour early. No, we'll wake up soon. I wanted to know how important a day it is for you today.
It's a very important day, I think, as well. A culmination of a lot of work that's gone in the background over the last number of months, particularly the last 4 months. So,
it's important to us, it's important to Madeleine.
I think that's right.
It's important to all those children elsewhere in Europe. So.
Mas, ao mesmo tempo, na Grã-Bretanha, a investigação policial ao desaparecimento de Madeleine está prestes a atingir um ponto crucial. Os inspectores portugueses chegam a Leicester.
Portuguese police are in the East Midlands tonight, preparing for fresh interviews with the seven friends who dined with Kate and Jerry McCann on the night their daughter Madeleine disappeared in May last year.
No Parlamento Europeu, Kate e Jerry McCann estão prestes a fazer a sua declaração aos deputados e à comunicação social. Para que a campanha tenha êxito, precisam do apoio de pelo menos metade dos 785 deputados do Parlamento Europeu.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Kate McCann. I'm Madeleine's mum. Madeleine was an incredibly happy, confident, and very loved little girl. And this time last year, we were a very happy family, and we felt very lucky. I'm unable to accurately convey to you just how totally devastating Madeleine's abduction has been on us as her parents and our family as a whole. If anyone was wanting to inflict the greatest amount of pain on us, they've certainly achieved that. And yet all that pales into insignificance when we find ourselves thinking about what Madeleine has been through. The pain of separation, confusion, the fear, absolute fear that she has had to endure. She's 4 years old. The sad and unbelievable fact is that Madeleine is not alone in being a victim of this sort of crime.
This declaration calls on member states to introduce a missing child alert
the activation of which shall require the immediate supply to relevant news media, border authorities, customs and law enforcement agencies, details of the missing child with her name, a photograph if available, information relevant to the disappearance of the child and or the suspected abductors, and a telephone number to call. Last year alone, 68 children in the United States were recovered as a direct result of the alert. That's a huge number. Very importantly, in 16 cases last year, the actual perpetrator released the child when they heard the alert. This has a deterrent effect as well.
We implore you to support our declaration. Please do not wait for another child and family to suffer as we have before agreeing to support the implementation of an alert system in Europe. Please sign your name to the declaration. Thank you.
Thank you. The McCanns spearheading this campaign, of course. Essentially, if a child was abducted anywhere in Europe, this system would put out a...
O apelo para a implementação de sistema de alerta amarelo está em todos os serviços noticiosos.
Kate and Jerry McCann are campaigning at the European Parliament for the...
They were here in Brussels to encourage MEPs to support an American-style fast alert system for when children go missing.
Sob todos os pontos de vista, o lançamento da campanha é grande êxito. Mas, ao fim do dia, o porta-voz do casal, Clarence Mitchell, recebe telefonema a alertá-lo para uma notícia de última hora.
We've just heard that apparently our witness statements have been leaked to the press from the Portuguese police.
O depoimento de Kate à polícia contém algo de novo. Uma coisa que Madeleine terá dito aos pais na manhã do seu desaparecimento.
We've had those statements for 11 and a half months. Why today, on all days, when we're in Brussels, trying to do something positive, have they been given to a journalist? And it also appears that, you know, the bits of the statement which have been chosen, which I have to say, we've told the police absolutely everything, because we want to give everything to find out what's happened, but the bits that have been chosen have been picked out of context, intentionally to smear us. And I think, you know, the whole thing is to detract from what we're doing today, and I feel absolutely gutted. I think it's an absolute disgrace. If the papers run with this tomorrow instead of, you know, what we've done today, I'll be devastated.
E, tal como temiam os McCann, o dia informativo de facto altera-se. Em vez de noticiarem alerta amarelo, todos os serviços noticiosos são dominados pelos seus depoimentos.
The details from police interviews taken when their daughter disappeared were leaked.
Transcripts suggest that on the morning she disappeared, their daughter Madeleine had asked her mother why she hadn't come when the children were crying the night before.
I'm really angry. Judicial secrecy should apply to everybody.
It's not coincidence. I think it's a sad indictment of a system that we've had to put up with.
A polícia portuguesa nega qualquer responsabilidade pela fuga de informação, mas seja qual for a fonte, os McCann sentem que o mal está feito. Uma vez mais, são lançadas suspeitas sobre eles.
Tell me what happened that morning. What Madeleine said.
Well, I can't remember if we just had breakfast. It was around, it was sort of fairly early in the morning, and she just very casually really said, "Where were you last night when me and Sean cried?" And we immediately looked and said, "You know, when was this, Madeleine? Was this when you were going to sleep?" And she didn't answer, and then she just carried on playing, totally undistressed.
Did she tell you off when she was saying it?
No. it was a passing remark, you know, and...
Madeleine's very articulate and for her age, and, yeah, it's unlike her, if she's got something to say, to drop it. She just literally dropped it. And we both kind of looked at each other and said, was it when we just put them down?
We obviously told the police because we thought, does this indicate that someone's been around the night before and that's what's woken her up? Which is significant, you know. I've persecuted myself over and over again about that statement because you think, why didn't I kind of just hold her and say, what do you mean, you know? What do you mean you woke up, you know, and kind of... But you don't think that. I mean, it's easy saying that after what's happened.
I think the worst thing is we kind of almost thought about not going. And did. We weren't sure we were going to get into the tapas, remember? And
in fact, we were all going to go up to the Millennium again. That was with the kids, which is what we did the first night. It was just because the walk was so long and we didn't have a buggy and the kids were tired by that time of night. But we did talk about going up to the Millennium that night.
But I mean, the worst thing is that you can't change any of that, and it doesn't help find her. And I think we've actually, despite, you know, our own guilt, we've tried to focus on what we can change. And, in the first few days, you know, obviously we focus much, much more on the negatives, and it doesn't help. Doesn't help Madeleine, doesn't help us, and it doesn't help find her.
I mean, it's not like you never think about it, because you do, you know, certainly, you know, you're perhaps a bit better at me at looking forward all the time, but, you know, I do go back and it does upset you and you think, why didn't I say, why did you cry, you know, and why didn't we go to the Millennium and blah, 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 you know, and then, as Jerry said, the guilt you feel for not being there and giving someone that opportunity, you know, but then I just have to kind of reel myself in and think, you know how much I love Madeleine, and I have no doubt that Madeleine knows how much, you know, I love her. And I think, I mean, I know that, and I've just got to think, regardless of what all those people say out there, you know, those bloggers and people on the forums who obviously get some kind of kick out of being nasty, I know that, and I know Madeleine knows that, and I've just got to kind of keep hold of that, really.
A família McCann completou um ano sem a Madeleine. Passados 12 meses, os pais possuem apenas uma informação considerada crucial.
There was a man seen walking away with Madeleine. Somebody knows who that man is. And he probably wasn't on his own. And somebody knows. And we need to find out who it is.
And the people with the information probably haven't come forward yet, for whatever reason. It might be fear of publicity, fear of authorities, but we need those people to come forward. Madeleine desperately needs those people to come forward. It doesn't feel like a year since I saw Madeleine. She's just so much, very much still there, and she doesn't seem that far away. It feels like she's still with me in some way. And I've never felt that I won't see her again.
She's still very much part of our life and the twins. You can see how much they love their big sister. I do think that she's still out there, very much so.
You know, I see Madeleine's best friend from time to time. Can't help but wonder, what would Madeleine be like? Would she be that much taller? You know, is her hair as long as that? You know, and would she be writing her name too? You know, she's there waiting for us. And she deserves us to keep going.
You're a little girl who wasn't even 4 and is now nearly 5. She's the victim, and people should not forget that.
She's there somewhere. It's just finding her.